Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Entrepreneur India's Resilience Series. India has over 500 internet users and 500 million internet users, and 300 million more are expected to join in the coming years. The country has 450 million smartphone users. There are more than 1,600 dialects in which people of this country converse. Now, if we put all this together, it means there is an enormous untapped market for communication in the preferred language of the people. But the revenue estimates run into thousands of crores of rupees. And so it is not surprising that the technology and startup community is waking up to this challenge and looking beyond English to serve Bharat. And that is what we are going to talk about today. I'm Saurav Kumar, Editor of Special Projects, Entrepreneur India, the moderator for this session. I'll quickly lay down the ground rules for our attendees. The discussion will go on for 30 minutes, and we'll take up questions after that for the next 15 minutes. If you have any questions during the course of the discussion, you can post them through the comment option. Mention in your question if it is directed towards any specific panel, and we'll take questions post the panel discussion. Let me now introduce our panelists for the day. We have with us today Mr. Arvind Pani, CEO and co-founder, Riveri Language Technologies, Mr. Tausif Khan, CEO and co-founder, Gramophone, and Mr. Lal Chand Bisu, CEO and co-founder, Cuckoo FM. Welcome, gentlemen. So to start with, I'll come to everyone, and you know, in very brief, if you can tell us that what is the market that you envisage beyond English in your respective fields? If you can give us some figures or estimates, that would be great. Tausif, if I can start with you.
I think when we are working with the farmers, the rural community, for us, the market, if from an agri landscape point of view, is more than like a $300 billion market, which is basically interacting needs like an interaction which is multilingual, and English would be the last like thing that this like market would look up to. So the solutions that you are building has to have like a very deep orientation towards local languages. So right now, like we are working, we started with more in a Hindi belt, and then we have started going towards Marathi, Gujarati, and other languages. So for us, direct market which we are working is more than like $300 billion, and then there are a lot of like indirect market which this community basically like needs any kind of retail ecosystem would be built around local languages.
Okay. Arvind?
Yeah, so I will take a little different approach to communicate what we are doing. In one statement, which is our vision is language equality on the internet. That means that we are working towards making internet accessible by every Indian in their language as easily as English is accessible today. Okay, so I will take this opportunity to really bust one myth which is there around languages, that we are now talking about what is the opportunity for language and whether it is the opportunity is now. In my opinion, this opportunity has always been there. It is just that on the internet, on digital, I'm talking about. It is just that the way we have designed the internet, it has consciously blocked all the users who don't understand English. The reason I'm saying this opportunity has always been there, that if you take all the traditional media, whether you take your newspaper, whether you take radio, you take television, you take cinemas, over 90% of the engagement always has happened in local languages in India, not in English. We in fact know that when channels like Star TV, MTV, these guys came to India with a bouquet of English only channels, thinking that they can actually replicate their global strategy here in India, they were in for a very rude shock and they had to change their strategy to go local. So that's the perspective that I would like to give. And our business model is that we enable other businesses to be able to engage with their audience in local languages. Whether it is a large enterprise like a bank, whether it is government delivering government to citizen services, right? So those are the segments that we work with. We reach out to the end users through other businesses or other entities that have got the reach. And mostly today the engagement is happening with English language users, and using our platform that could be done with local language users. So our market is, it is exactly the same market, the 90% of the market that is consuming print media or television, cinema, going to cinema, and those are the areas that they are spending on. Those are also the same audience who will basically spend on the internet.
Okay. I think that's only one part of it. I think, you know, that media and communication, I think apart from that, if we put together all these startups and their services, I think the market size would increase multifold. And I think Lalchand, you would want to add on that.
Yeah. Okay. So let me start from. So actually, this is, I'm second time entrepreneur. I started my first company in 2012. At that time, also I was able to connect that in India, like everyone will go on the internet. And at that time, you just were only using English thing. So company, I was thinking that I will provide good quality education to Hindi users, the local language users. In 2020, I started my second company with the vision that make life better off the screen. And I started with Hindi. So actually, we entrepreneurs and investors live in future. We are not only just covering the gap in the present time. We live in future. We connect the dots in the future and what is going to be the next big thing. And this... this local language market is the next big thing, actually. Like in India, if you see that by 2030, there will be 1 billion internet users. Out of them, around 800 million users will be local language users. So you can clearly see that this is a very big market and everyone have opportunity to do something here. And these users still don't have like lot of things to consume. Like they don't have enough content to consume. They don't have enough services to go in their own local language. So for sure, this is a big market. And in this market, we are covering this audio space. We are making life better off the screen. So we are a podcast platform. We started in Hindi in 2018. First 2 years, we spent only in Hindi. We created our playbook and we got like awesome results in Hindi language. Our like users are spending around 1 hour daily, average time 1 hour daily on our platform. So that's like very great results.
Yeah, so I think I was reading somewhere. So a podcast alone is a 10,000 crore plus market going to be by 2023. And if I go by what Arvind said, that you know 90% of the consumption is in the local language. So I would believe that the local language podcast business itself is a 9,000 crore business. If I'm not wrong, would you agree?
Yeah. It will go beyond that, I think. If you connect the dots, if you even look the past things, so a complete Bollywood exists in Hindi and there is other languages, they have their own cinema. So we were consuming content in our own languages. It is just that internet reached out to first English users. But if you see the complete picture, you see the 1 billion users on internet in India, out of them 800 million users will consume content in their own language. So this is a very big market. Like I think it will go in $1 trillion market.
Right. Okay. So you're as optimistic as I am that, you know, there's going to be a big market. So Tausif, I'll come to you. You know, during this COVID, you know, obviously social distancing and everything has become the norm, and I think it's going to be with us for some time. So what has been the impact in terms of, you know, communicating, because you communicate with farmers, essentially they do not speak English, they would speak Hindi or their one of the regional languages. So, you know, has it changed your plans? Like you said that you started with English, Hindi, and then you had Marathi and Gujarati. So has it, you know, expedited some of your plans towards adopting more regional languages onto your platform?
Yeah. So I think we always like had plans to basically get into other like regional languages. But with COVID, I think one thing that has happened is a lot of regional activities that were done physically, that has stopped. So I think more than localization in terms of introducing new languages, form of communication to people overall has changed from physical like approach to a digital approach. And we have seen the similar thing happening in the rural areas as well. Like our entire communication with farmers, we used to do on a daily basis, like at least 20 to 30 like farmer meetings, on ground farmer meetings. Now they have converted into digital like platform. We actually like share Zoom links, Google Hangout to farmers, and we see farmers joining them, Facebook Live, YouTube Live, and all these are in regional languages, obviously. So from an adoption point of view, I think today, overall technology adoption in rural areas has increased a lot. And I think the challenge is localization in terms of context, at least for us. Probably Arvind would be the right like person to take this ahead. But in agriculture, even if I convert it into Hindi, then there is another problem that you have to go to the local dialect level. A same disease and a pest problem would be called in a different name, different tone in MP East, and in MP West it would be different. So that level of like challenge is there when you are basically building apps or web-based like platform for these people, and they want to like interact with you. So I think that's where the market basically and the solutions have to become more real time on these front, where building your dictionaries around these specific problems is not yet there, at least at for people like us. So we ourselves are building or partnering with other like such organizations so that we can like accelerate this aspects. So during COVID, like definitely that adoption has increased, and I'm seeing that it has at least like accelerated by another like 1 to 2 years more, I would say. Now, what Jio had done accelerated, and this has accelerated it in terms of adoption. At that point of time, it was primarily, I should say, users had come in, but adoption had not like happened that way. Now adoption has happened.
I think this is a very important point, actually. He added that in India, we need our own solutioning. Like it is not that English product, just they will add one more language and our users will start consuming. We need our own solutioning. That's why like even Facebook added Hindi language, everyone language, but ShareChat is the biggest social platform. You will see these platforms in other languages also, because it is not just the adding one more languages. It is about the solutioning to our own people. We consume content in different way. We consume services in different way. So it is a very important point, actually.
So Saurav, may I add? So this is a very interesting question that you asked. And that how do you relate languages with this pandemic that happened? Right. Okay. Before I share that, let me ask this question. Now we have about 1 billion people in India who have got Aadhaar card. Right, and it has been the mission of that particular initiative to cover everybody. Now, there was also an initiative where citizens were requested to link their Aadhaar to PAN cards, right? And around that time, through various channels, predominantly SMS, and then of course you go to the web and then link your Aadhaar. Do you remember ever one message coming to us in a language other than English? I mean, 1 billion people who have got Aadhaar card, they have been getting messages that you need to link your PAN card. only in one language, that is in English language. And how are they even expected? Do we expect that 1 billion people understand English? But that all quickly changed, that realization really quickly changed when this pandemic happened. So at the beginning of the pandemic, when you realize that there is not much information available, the only thing that you could do is really create awareness about safety and reach out to nook and corner of the country. Center and state, every state, okay, they have been communicating with their citizens in local languages. That everybody realized that there was no way we could reach out to Indians in only in English language. So 2-3 initiatives that even we have seen during that time that have really helped. One is that if you look at the initial messages that were by our Prime Minister and those were addressed to the nation. So those were in Hindi language, and we used our technology to really localize all those videos into multiple languages, and those were circulated quite widely for information dissemination. The other one is the MyGov COVID website, which is there. So that is also using one of our platforms called Vada, that's a site publishing platform, right? And that has got information in 9-10 languages. The other interesting thing was that there was telemedicine helplines which were there. And a conventional way to be able to set up a telemedicine helpline where you could record those voices by a voiceover artist and then record in a studio. A very simple IVR, right, would take about, say, anywhere between 72 to 96 hours to do that, right? So during that time, we also used our technology to be able to generate those IVR voiceovers, and we reduced the time for these helplines to go live from 96 hours to under 3 hours. So yes, you are absolutely right. And it was kind of a wake-up call that in a pandemic, in an emergency situation like this, when you want to reach out to the citizens, to the masses, then you cannot rely on English language. And the same analogy holds true for businesses as well.
Yeah, I'm sure I would add to that, post, like when this pandemic started, after a few days, when I was calling my friends in West Bengal, so in Bengali, the telecom operators had recorded that, the COVID is not over, we have to stay away. And if calling someone in, Andhra, so in Telugu language, I was hearing the same message translated. So I think very quickly we realized that, we need to communicate to people in the language that they understand the best, and that is their mother tongue, possibly. And, to the other point that Tausif was making, that, one thing is about creating a solution. The other thing is about adoption of that solution, which he mentioned that there are various smaller dialects. Like if he has to communicate that particular pest that he has, as he said, that in some language it might be something else, in some language it could be spelled differently or pronounced differently or something else. So how do we do that? I mean, that's the infrastructure sort of challenge that you were talking about. Is it the same thing?
Saurabh, is that a question that you are addressing to me?
Yes.
See, India is unique in terms of, one is that the number of languages which are there. Okay. And even if we say, take into account only the languages which have got official status, we are still talking about 22 languages. And among those, again, the most popular ones, popular in the sense, the most widely spoken ones. Yeah. Are still about 11 or 12 languages. And then you have this challenge of every 40 kilometers in India, the dialect changes. Okay. But technology has come to a stage where you could say if it is Hindi, then you can actually accommodate most of the popular dialects into language. The infrastructural challenge that I was talking about was a little different from this. Okay. And I will give you 2-3 examples which will simplify this. Now, if you take English, the number of alphabets which are there. English alphabets, universally, anywhere you go, there are 26. You ask anybody, that's something that we have read in our books. Okay. But let's take Hindi. 40% of India's population speaks Hindi language. Forget about other languages. Even for Hindi, we still do not have digital standards that can say that these are our character sets. I mean, you would be surprised to know that the Hindi characters which are taught in school are actually not in sync with what is being followed as digital standard for Hindi language. There are 8 to 10 characters, new characters, which have been introduced in Hindi language, which kids don't even know when they are studying in the textbook in schools, right? So when they start growing up and using digital, the entire digital medium for Indian languages is very confusing for them. So that's one of the infrastructure challenges that I was talking about, right? And similarly for other things, we do not have a standard yet for our Indian language typing keypads, okay? For example, in English, QWERTY is a standard, but for Indian languages, we don't have that. And the most unfortunate part is that India still is not standing up and owning or taking the responsibility of defining these standards. These standards are being owned by bodies which sit outside of India, represented by companies that are not Indian. Indian languages are represented by people who don't understand the nuances of the languages. So that is why I say, like building a good road, no matter how good car you have, unless we build a good infrastructure, good road, then there is no point having great cars. So similarly, unless we fix our standards, our computing, on top of which we can build content, and there are a lot more people who technologically who can contribute towards that, it's not going to happen. So those are the infrastructural challenges that I was talking about. That aside, the other thing I would also like to mention is that we are still trying to adapt everything which is there in English on the internet to Indian languages. There are very few businesses like Cuckoo FM and all who are building ground up for Indian languages. Now, more and more businesses should start thinking that India is not an English speaking country first and then Indian languages. It's an Indian language country first, then English. So what happens if we flip our design philosophy, saying that we will design the internet and the user experience for Indian languages first, and then we will plug in English. So those are some of the complete change in perspective that we need to have when we are designing for Indian language users.
So, you know, Tausif, I'll come to you. As I see that, you know, as Lal Chin was also saying that, you know, 800 million people, you know, consuming in their own languages. So, you know, I see the possibilities being endless. You know, you are into agriculture, but there is gaming, there is education, which Lal Chin earlier had talked about. Then there is education, obviously, is there. Then there, you know, so is it like an endless pit that we can go on and explore, or am I being a little more optimistic than I should be?
No, I think you're right. Like, if you start thinking about it, then actually it's endless. Whatever is we are doing, we have limited the use cases to English like languages. But I think as the language, technology, and computing power, everything has like increased over the last like decade. Possibility of localizing it has increased exponentially, I would say, and because of that possibility, now solution building the solutions for the consumer is done in a way that it is very, very user friendly. So now so I think like Arvind was mentioning, the design thinking in terms of I will build it in English, convert it into this language. That was the methodology, and that's typically the methodology that has been used by companies. But now with all these things happening, I think in this decade, it would start like going reverse. So the solutions would be similar, but I think communication would be different. And for any company, so if it's a large like company, typically they will have resources to maybe even you have developed same thing. You have three parallel teams or like 10 parallel teams working for English language, and then there will be a Hindi language, then there will be a Marathi, then there will be a third other language. So that resources would go in those 10 parallel like streams. But with all these like tech coming in, I think the cost of doing that it would be lower. So therefore the solutions for the people masses would be can be built by any like company at a much lower cost because you can automatically like do a large portion of it. So therefore you rightly like said that the possibilities are endless, and that is what we will see in this decade happening, that it will become like very real time. To just give you an example, when we started in 2016, we actually built our app first in English and then we converted it into Hindi. So our structure today is also that you have one language, you can convert it into another language, then third language, then fourth language. You can do that. It's not that difficult. We are doing it. But now when we are going 3 years, 4 years ahead, I need to actually interact with the farmer in a real-time basis. So once we are going more towards conversational like bots or like methodologies in which farmers generally like interact with the retail ecosystem. So I need like those real-time methodologies in which just like a Google Allo or a Google Assistant, we are trying to build it for the farmers. So my local context for agriculture is required, which we are building, but we are using this similar like language conversion, translation, transliteration, and all those things through other like technology providers. So it has become a little like easier for them to us today than it was like 4 years back. And I imagine that it would become more easy and accurate going forward because of what has happened. So therefore, I think making it contextual for my user, it become difficult. So my user acquisition, customer acquisition becomes easier. So I think that's how I look at it. So now it can be, I am working in agriculture. It could be even in gaming industry. It could be like in retail. It could be in any other like industry. So the same thing would apply to any other industry.
Okay. Before I go to next question, I'll again request our audience to keep their questions coming. We'll start taking them up in a couple of minutes. So, you know, that brings me to the point that, you know, Tausif, you said that, you know, we need to develop solutions, you know, in different languages. So I think there is a cost attached to it. So I'll come to Lalchand and Arvind for this, for the answer to this. So the cost attached to, you know, developing, like Tausif talked about, you know, chatbot. So, you know, to make a machine learn that language is as expensive as making English, well, making a machine learn English language. So obviously when you talk about English, then it, you know, you can use it worldwide. But when you're talking about Marathi or Bengali or Gujarati, it's very, you know, geographical. So how is the ROI on these kind of experiments, or you know, if that kind of solution is there, how much is it going to cost a startup to adopt that? Arvind, if I can start with you and go to Lal after that.
Yeah, sure. See, in my opinion, that is actually an unfounded fear or myth. Okay, you look at when you look at television, how many advertisements do we see, or total ad spend on television or say radio? How much of ad spend actually happens in English language? How many advertisements do we see in English? Majority of the advertisements we actually see are in local languages. And these are the same consumers that we are targeting. That's one. Second one is, it is an unfair comparison when we say that when it is English, it is global. And in local languages, our opportunity sizes come down. Now, India itself is such a vast country that one language, if you take one language of a state, that itself could be representative of the size of many smaller countries. And then if you take Europe, these are like advanced countries. Okay. We are not talking about these countries who are behind India in terms of their development and infrastructure. You take France, Germany, or even China. Okay, which of these countries have really allowed English to grow at the expense of their own language? None of these countries. So what they have done is that the fundamental difference of what they have done, they have built, like Tausif was mentioning, there's a reverse thought process that we need to really imbibe in ourselves, that they have built their entire digital ecosystem and other things as well ground up for their local languages. And English is also a part of that ecosystem, right? That includes their education system as well. These countries that I mentioned, most of the South Asian countries or even European countries, even their education system, their internet, everything is built ground up in their languages, and English is also part of that. So when that happens, the usability, ease of use is much, much better than really when you're starting everything. When everything starts in English, then you already have a barrier mentally that I need to learn technology, I need to learn English to be able to navigate through English to my language. So those are big deterrent factors which are there. So I really challenge this hypothesis that what is ROI or what is the opportunity? I think on digital or internet, we haven't even gotten started where we can deliver that kind of experience, right? And wherever that experience is there, which is what I'm talking about as equality of access, where you are able to engage with a medium where engaging in your language is the effort that it takes is no different from what it takes for English language. There is a lopsided demand for Indian languages. That's what happened with television, with the newspaper, with cinemas, with radio, all of those. So internet needs to get to a stage where Indian language users have to be able to use it without having to rely on English at all.
Fair point. Lal, you were talking, you know, we were, before this, we were talking about the monetization part of it. So obviously Arvind, you know, very well put that, you know, ROI is something that we should not think about because it's a huge, huge opportunity which is available there. What's your opinion?
Yeah, as Arvind told, I think it is the same cost as whatever you are developing in English, like the server cost, the development cost, the distribution cost, everything is cost the same as English. If we talk about monetization, I think in last 3 to 4 years, we have seen a like massive development in Indian finance ecosystem. And the biggest credit goes to UPI. Last month, we did 2 billion transactions on UPI. And if you see that these are we people, the religion, we local people are doing these transactions. It will change everything. Like we were like, when it started the internet wave in India, everyone know that there will be like 800 million local internet users. Everyone know that this is the mass thing, but how we will monetize it? Now I think everyone is started thinking that this will be easy because UPI changed everything. The microtransaction will happen, the recurring payment, they are also starting. And we have seen that we are in a field where we are providing meaningful content to users. When we talk to our users, when we ask them that when in future we will charge for this content, they said, yes, we can pay for this content easily, 100 rupees to 200 bucks easily. So the behavior changes I have seen in last 2-3 years is massive. Like everyone is very comfortable doing these digital transactions. And this is happening in local India. Like everyone is very comfortable now. So I think now entrepreneur and VCs are very comfortable with that. Yeah, we have enough market and enough transaction will also happen in this market.
Okay. So what you mean is that with ease of payment now with UPI, obviously is the biggest trail and people like WhatsApp and Google Pay, others are using it. So with the ease of payment, you believe that people will start paying for these regional offerings and that would make it more easier for offerings to be in that language. Is that what you said, right?
Yeah. Actually, the biggest barrier in internet transaction is the first transaction. Like when we also started on the internet, the first transaction was on e-commerce. From that, we went to Ola and Uber. From that, we went to OTT platforms. Now we have 3-4 subscriptions on OTT platform. But these local users who are onboarded first time on internet, they are afraid to do transaction on internet. But right. The UPI made it so easy that they are no more afraid. They will not take 5 to 7 years to do transaction on OTT platform. We took that time because there was a learning curve, and we need to comfort ourselves that yes, we are paying someone and we will get return something. But what UPI changed this, like now they don't need 6-7 years to be comfortable to do transaction on the internet. They are doing today, actually.
Okay. So we'll take some questions that have come to us on our Facebook. So, Swati has asked this question to Tausif. Since Gramophone directly engages with farmers, how would language localization be stitched into the digital interface? I think partly you have answered that question, but still, if you can, add to that.
Can you repeat the question?
So since Gramophone directly engages with farmers, how would language localization be stitched into the digital interface that you provide? So I think partly you have answered that question, but is anything more to that?
No, I think that's pretty like imperative for us that it is already like stitched into the local like interfaces that we have. So for the farmers, for us, the first like language is Hindi, Marathi. English is not the default language, which we have like even set on the app if somebody installs it. So for by default, it is Hindi. And then like he has the option to actually like change it to any other language. So I think any business who is so like us, who is so dependent on the local like interactions, we have been like aware of that like fact. And from day one, all technologies which we have like built or products we have built are built in that localized way. Now, I think the next level of it, there are a lot of internal tools that we use in which the consumers are people who are maybe educated, are employees who basically work at the last mile. But then they are also, English is not the preferred like language for them. But still, like some of the solutions are in English for them because these are static like information, and you regularly use, you get used to it. So we have not gone ahead and converted it into a local like format. But I think the natural thing over there, like a call center agent who is taking calls, there the interface is still like we have it in English. We don't have it in Hindi. But the better thing to do over there would also be Hindi. So I think gradually, even thinking like Arvind was talking about, that when you're designing these like things, you would think that let me design it in a local language methodology in itself than like thinking of English and doing this. So I think this phase, the newer like companies who are coming up probably would do that, but it's always for a startup. I think when you are in that bootstrapped and you are working in a different like methodology, you would minimize the resource like which would go into multiple like languages. You would go for like maybe the language which would give you the maximum like bang for the buck. So that's how the decisions are like made. But just to answer and elaborate on that, I think having a local language is a no-brainer right now. So everybody is on that.
Just for my information, this change in language would also include, I believe, the numbers, right? Because one thing that I have always noticed for a long, long time, and I've been talking, I believe is very important, is that you can give someone a solution, but if the digits that one has to use is again the English digits that one is using, again it's a brain state for a lot of people. So I hope that the solutions also include numericals, right?
No, I think it's an interesting point. Also, this is my like understanding. We have kept the numbers in English itself because. The assumption over there is that from a currency point of view, people like still use English. Most of them like understand that. That's my understanding. I might be wrong actually, but as of now we have not done that. That we have converted the numbers as well into a local language. It is in English still, but it's a like question.
I would like to add that actually Tausif is right. So nobody understands the language of. I mean, everybody understands the language of money the best. Okay. So therefore, money, whether it is coin or whether it is notes, everything is printed in English, the digits. At least everybody knows the digits. So even whatever user research that we have done and user feedback that we have got, they have always preferred, majority of them have preferred to have the digits in English instead of changing it to local languages.
Yeah.
But you know, I'll just want to point out, isn't it contrary to what you were saying earlier? Because see, I'll give you an example of Bangladesh. When Bangladesh was doing a financial inclusion, they actually implemented their local Bengali script, the numericals, is because that is the one that they understand the best. Now you said that European countries and China and everyone, you know, they build up that way that, you know, they everything is in their language. So the numericals is also would be, I don't know in what, you know, in what they would be using. But isn't it fair that, you know, if someone is, you know, koi Hindi mein padhta hai, to uski Hindi ki one, you know, is like this. It's not like, you know, straight one. That the three is has a curve down there. So isn't it fair to give them the that opportunity to, you know, learn? Use that numerical as well.
Yeah. So see, in digital, you always have. I'm completely in favor of giving the option to the user, right? You don't mandate saying that okay, you use just English numerals or you Roman numerals or you use the local language numerals. When it is digital, you can always give them the option and whichever they are comfortable with, they can pick up. So I'm not saying that. You just stick to Roman numerals.
And is that a possibility which can be easily implemented?
Yeah. That can be very easily implemented.
Okay.
That's not difficult at all.
Anyone wants to add or we can move to the next question?
Okay. No, so, I think,
next question. Yes, please, Prasad.
No, so I was just like saying that you took the example of Bangladesh probably. I'm not sure, but even maybe like I had taken by hunch the example of currency, but it could be that yeah, on the currency also they would be using the similar language, local language in itself over there. So therefore, the decision would have been that let's include this. But for India, I think even on the currency, the primary thing that is comes language. Is English, and that is common across the country. So therefore, that understanding is there over here in India that one means this, two means this, three means this. So that's my hunch and understanding. But I think it's a question that needs more like user research.
Okay. So next question is for Arvind. What are the much needed policy changes to build a seamless digital engagement for our language first customers? Right now, there is a huge gap vis-a-vis the English language. So yeah, policy changes basically, I think, is what to make digital seamless engagement.
Yeah. So this is something that I addressed when we were structure aspect. Okay. First and foremost, at a policy level, we must take all Indian languages definition of standards into our hands instead of letting it being defined by foreign countries and foreign companies. Okay. And there are clear, like any other language, we also have our own, those are the same ones. So we need to take care of standardizing our character sets in Indian languages. Those are not standardized. We need to standardize our keypad, right? Like English has got QWERTY, that is standard for Indian languages. Then we also need to take into account that in terms of properties, Indian languages are different from English or Roman based languages. Those are linear languages. That means a word is formed by combination of characters where they don't combine to change shape. Okay. For example, if you are writing cricket, C-R-I-C-K-E-T, that is in English. It's pretty straightforward and it is linear. Whereas if you are typing that in Indian language, say in Hindi, you are writing ka, halant, ra, e, ka, a, and ta. And all of these characters combine to form a shape, right? So apart from standardizing the character sets, there are also clear logic that how Indian language characters need to combine, right? So that is also something that needs to be done. What is very interesting about this is that even now, if you take our names, okay? Now let's take the case of Tausif. Now, somebody who does not understand Indian names, 90 to 95% of names are like this, Tausif. If I'm not Indian and I read his name, which is written in English, I will actually read as Tausif. In Indian languages or in English, there is no representation of characters like ta, tha, da. Similarly, my name is Ni, P-A-N-I, it stands Pani. But it is everybody who reads this, they pronounce my name as Arvind Pani. So to maintain the sanctity of English languages, we have not gone ahead and introduced new characters which are very common in India. So 90 to 95% of our names itself will have these kind of representations and include those in English. Then why have we gone ahead and included foreign characters into Indian languages and made it corrupt? So these are some of the standardization initiatives at a policy level that we need to take care of, for which India really needs to own those and say that, okay, we will define the standards and give it to any standardization bodies globally, saying that you go and adopt this. And then all the companies who are doing business in India, they actually follow those. Instead of the other way being other way where these are defined elsewhere and given to India, that now you go and adopt.
There's a question from Jeet. Jeet, can we give the mic to Jeet? Jeet, can you unmute yourself and ask your question? I think I'll read out the question that he has sent. He said that, what are your views on government trying to make Hindi language default all over India? Will this benefit companies and startups, or they would preserve regional languages? Well, a little complicated, but I understand what he wants to ask is that is obviously Hindi is not the default language that can be, made default for, and you know, Lalchan, if you would want to take that question, that obviously you would have experienced that, the people in Maharashtra or Gujarat would need to listen to whatever podcast or there is in their language rather than in Hindi. So I don't think that's the case, right?
Yeah, actually you can't push one language on others. We are doing work in Hindi, Marathi, Gujarati because these people can't understand English. If you push Hindi to learn Tamil peoples, that you also learn Hindi. So this is the same thing. It is same saying that everyone learn English. If you ask everyone to say you like in Hindi is the compulsory now. So that's the same thing. I think we need to make the solution according to their own languages, wherever they are comfortable. So I think everyone from the regions, they learn in their own languages. In Tamil Nadu, they learn in Tamil. We learn in Hindi. Some people learn in Marathi. So they consume content in their own languages. So we started in Hindi, and we have seen this behavior like. When we were Hindi for first two years, we were getting requests from all these people from Gujarat. They consume Hindi, but they were asking us to give them content in Gujarati. Some people were consuming on our platform in Hindi. These are users from Marathi, Maharashtra. They were asking us to create content in Marathi. So we have seen this behavior. Like when we were only in Hindi, we were getting so much requests from these local people that we should put content in their own languages. So I think that this is not the way that you make mandatory the Hindi language for everyone. We should make the solutions for the in their own languages. Right. That's the right solution.
So, gentlemen, we have run out of time, but still we have some questions. So I think just a couple of questions, if you'll allow me to ask. So Nishu has asked this question that among all the regional languages apart from Hindi, which one has the most potential or reach in terms of users when it comes to internet? And I think what she means is that if someone is doing a business, so what is that language apart from Hindi which has the most potential? Arvind, Tosef?
Yeah, so Tosef, you want to take that? Go ahead. No,
I think you would be the right person to answer this.
We have seen that apart from Hindi, which is kind of 40% coverage it has got, the other languages which have got fairly large coverage, one is your Bangla, Bengali. And that is not just in India, Bangladesh also, it's the same script which is there, Bangla. Then you have some of the South Indian languages like Tamil, Telugu, right? And even to a large extent, Malayalam. So these would be some of the languages which would follow Hindi.
Marathi is also big, I think.
Marathi is also quite big. In the West, Marathi is quite big.
Okay. Yep. There's another question from Sanju. He asked that I'm exploring a media startup which will cater to people speaking any language. Do you think there is enough demand for it? I think, Lalchand, I would toss that question to you because you are already doing something similar.
Yeah, we are a media company. We are doing in audio. And you can see this behavior from all the existing platforms to like new platforms like us. All the existing platforms, Netflix, Hotstar, Ghana Sound, everyone is trying to cover this regional languages now. They are releasing their product in Hindi, Marathi, Bengali, in all these languages. We started in Hindi and now we are covering other parts. And I think the media is the thing that people want to consume in their own languages. Even if you see us, like I can see Hollywood movies, like English movies. But like whenever the good Hindi movies comes, Bollywood movies comes, I used to go to theaters. Still, I watch Hindi things. So, because I born and bottom in Hindi language. So everyone want to consume content, media content, at least in their own language. So when like, even when you go in the smaller areas, like in Rajasthan, there is more than I think 5 languages in that region. They want to consume their own languages. So like everyone is very comfortable consuming content in their own languages. And we are also creating content according to the demand. Actually, demand is very high. Like we are not able to cope the demand. So we are creating the content in their own languages, whatever they are consuming. And they are very comfortable to consume in their own languages. As I also before told you that when we were in Hindi, people who are consuming in Hindi, like they understand Hindi very well, but they were demanding content in Gujarati, Punjabi, Marathi. They were consuming in Hindi, but they were asking content in their own languages because they are very comfortable in their own language.
I think that's the pull of the mother tongue. I think har koi apni hi mother tongue mein sabse zyada comfortable hota hai aur samajhna bhi sabse zyada aasan hai apni language mein. So I think that is the I would believe. So the one last question that we have, we'll take and then we'll wrap it up is that how expensive is it to implement multi-language solutions for an existing product? Is it worth the return? Tosef, I think I'll toss this one to you.
So I think the answer to that question is that how dependent are you on that type of like customers? So whether you should invest into that or not, is answer lies over there. But I think if I look at our journey, for us, it's not that like expensive actually. If you are trying to basically convert it into some other languages, the challenge comes if there is a real time like conversion. A lot of like conversion is static in nature. If that's the kind of like services you are into or product into, then it's a easier like job. But if it is something which is dynamic in nature, real time, then I think the solution would be different. So, so from a investment point of view also, it would not be just like an investment of in technology. Probably from marketing, you will need a different kind of a structure around that, content management, and then like promotion strategies would be different. So yes, if you are going or your consumer like set is that way, then you'll have to invest in all these like verticals, which can become a significant investment. But the answer to that question is that what kind of uptick you are envisaging, that whether it will bring significant number of like consumers to your like platform or users to your platform, the answer lies in there. Over there, I think Arvind can answer specifically in terms of costs of doing that. But
yes, I actually wanted to ask Arvind about a specific cost, if they can, you know, bust this myth about people that okay, if you're, what is the cost, Arvind? I have a solution. I have a website. I have it in English now. I want to do it in Hindi. I want to do it in Bengali. How much are you going to charge me?
Yeah. So that's it. This is a great question, and I'm glad that this has come up. And it's quite natural when I have a business and I think of making it available in multiple languages to get overwhelmed by the fact that, okay, there are at least 10 or 11 languages and how do I go about it? Okay. Now, Tausif has actually summarized it very well. If you are really looking at doing it in a very conventional services way, then it might be expensive for you. But if you are leveraging technology, right, then you can treat the entire bundle of Indian languages to be one solution. And you are not going to incur cost for every single language differently. You are probably going to, whether it is one language or 10 language, the cost to implement that, right, will be one time, and that is going to be same whether it is one or 10 languages. Now, the benefit of technology is that you do not have to incur all those expenses or investment right up front. You can implement that, and based on usage, right, you may incur expenses. And how does it matter if your large part of your usage is coming, let's say, from Maharashtra, okay? Then 40% of your usage is coming from Maharashtra. Then obviously you are paying for that usage in Marathi language. So your overall size of 100 remains the same, and you can just spread your cost depending on what kind of language is being used. So my suggestion would be that don't look at in a fragmented way that if I'm spending X for say one language, then it is 10X for 10 languages. No. It is probably 1.1x or 1.2x at best for all the 10 languages. And then depending on usage, and usage automatically justifies your ROI as well.
Yes, actually, when you have a ready one playbook for one languages, then you can replicate it to other languages. So we were working for 2 years in Hindi. In last 6 to 7 months, we released 6 more languages. It was that easy. You just need to replicate that playbook in other languages. In our case, we also need the content in that language. So we have to hire the language expert in every language, because otherwise we will not understand what is going on in that content. We need one language expert, and other things are like the text and the behavior of the users and the personalization of the content is same for other languages. So it is not that like, if you are replicating in 10 languages, then the cost will not be 10x. It is like 1.2x kind of thing.
That's great. That really clarifies my doubt also, you know, in terms of how expensive is it going to be to implement others. So, gentlemen, we've really run out of, we've overshot the time actually, but it was so interesting that I did not want to stop it. And thank you so much, Arvind, Lalchand and Tausif, for being here today and speaking on a subject which is really close to my heart as well, because I believe that India is a country of, you know, so, of so many languages, and so solutions to everyone should be in the language that they understand. And I hope that with today's discussion, a lot of myths would have been busted for entrepreneurs who want to implement such solutions. So thank you so much, everyone, and wishing you everyone a very happy Diwali.
Thank you, Tausif. Thank you, Saurabh.
Great talking to you.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Yeah, thank you, everyone. Happy Diwali.
With all of you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.